My name is Thomas Henschel. I'm making a game called Archmage Rises, and I'm slightly crazy. There is a warning that I need to put at the beginning of this, and that is I'm about to talk about features that are not yet complete. The best kind of postmortem is the one that's actually done at the end. This is near the end of this particular feature. So, you know, I thought I would be done by this point. I'm not. So yeah, you get what you get. So anyways, this is the state the game's in. This is what I can show you. And if you're not like overly impressed, I am. And what I mean by that is I have seen the technology do its part, and then I broke the game last week, and then I had to like put it back together in order to be able to like make a demo, make some screenshots, and they're not the best screenshots that I could possibly make because of this fundamental change that just occurred to the game. So anyway, I'm not finished. The second thing is some of the things I'm about to tell you may sound obvious, but I say them because they need to be reiterated. They like just to raise that priority. Sometimes the things we're most familiar with are kind of like low priority in our thinking in terms of design and stuff, and so they're higher priority than maybe you think. This is a design talk, not a programming talk, so I believe it's accessible to everybody. It does get a little bit crunchy, but don't worry, the waters aren't that deep. This is not actually Alan Turing, but anyways, this is who played him in the movie Imitation Game. And so he created this thing called the Turing test, maybe you've already heard of. And in the Turing test, the idea is a test that sees if a person in one room is communicating through a screen and keyboard to a person in another room, if they can tell if the person responding is a person or a computer. If they think it's a person and it was actually a computer, that passes the Turing test. And that was an important milestone in AI history. Quite a while ago, and we have chatbots now, and we find them annoying and whatever. But anyway, that was an important thing. And so, the passing the Turing test is the ability to judge that what an AI created looks kind of natural or human-like. And so I want to say very proudly that I was talking with Emily, and she is formerly a 3D artist at Soma, and I was showing her like a screenshot of what I was working on, and she says, sweet, are these going to be randomly generated? And so I passed the visual Turing test on what it is that I'm working on. So that made me real happy. So thanks for that, Emily. What I'm talking about is procedural generation, and procedural generation, I would say, is a field that is very young. I've been working on my game for the last 5 years. I announced it actually 5 years ago at this conference and thought I'd be done in two, so shows you what I know. But it is a very young field, and I've enjoyed working in it, and I'm here to share with you you know, some of the things that I've learned along the way. And if you want to jump into doing procedural stuff too, you can. This human head was generated procedurally. That's why I put it there. Procedural generation sucks your time like a black hole. And not a regular black hole, but a supermassive black hole. So, like I said, there's 5 years of struggle that has gone into this. And there's like, if you've seen the movie Interstellar, when you get close to a black hole, there's like time dilation and things end up taking like way longer. That's exactly what procedural is like. Like I've just been buried in doing these 3D dungeons for 6 months instead of 6 weeks. And as I just told you, I'm not even done yet, but I'm pretty close to the end again. That's why I feel confident about doing this. Don't reinvent the wheel. Make certain that you are familiar with the body of knowledge that exists out there, right? So being algorithm oriented, you know, I have to see what else is going on out there. And so that was really important for like whatever part of your game you're gonna go and work on is like see what other people are doing. And I know that's kind of obvious, but in the case, I'll show you in a second of procedural generation, like it was very important for me to see like what is going on out there and what can I utilize from what other people are doing, and do I really have to make these aspects myself? So the short answer is you don't have to do what I just did. There's this cool thing called Dungen. It's a plugin thing, an asset for Unity. And I'll just show you 20 seconds of their little video so that you can kind of see. This is handcrafted rooms in a procedural layer. There. So you just got like a quick idea. Like, there's already something out there that you could just like plug into your project. I don't even know what the cost is, 50 bucks, 70 bucks, something like that, in order to do that. So, I don't want you to run. No, I didn't use it at all. And I'll get into that. So that's the first thing. I looked at it, and I'll explain why in a second why I didn't do that. Again, just searching around, looking for things, I found this site. This is just like some random guy who wrote a really interesting blog post about random dungeon generation, and he links to a lot of the algorithms that are out there and assets and stuff. I actually got a lot from this guy's single post. It was just like some guy like you, like me, like just like tooling around with 3D dungeon generation, just tooling around and stuff. And he's like, hey, here's what I found. So I slurped all that up and started doing my thing. So that's a good website. I read this book cover to cover, Procedural Generation and Game Design. There's very few books on procedural generation. This is one of them. It goes in depth on a number of algorithms, talking about the current state of where procedural's at, where they expect it to go, the kind of Turing test or whatever that we need to, get past. And so it's a good book. You should read it. Tarn Adams, if you don't know, is the designer and developer of Dwarf Fortress, right? So he knows a few things about procedural generation. They have 5 chapters in that book specifically on level or dungeon generation, right? So 5 different ways of going about it. And one of them that's really interesting is the cyclical algorithm. So always creating a dungeon that loops around to the beginning, and that's actually more fun for players. They've been able to test that and prove that that's a better design than getting into these dead ends and having to come all the way back. So the loop, we talk about game loops a lot, but actually there should be a level loop. Am I dumb? Like, there's like, ropes and stuff and I'm just like throwing them away and like, just like, yeah, screw that. I'm just going to do this crazy, hard, ridiculous thing, on my own, to prove my manlyhood or something. I already have 3 kids. I've proven my manlyhood. So why not just use like what's out there, right? And so I'm going to tell you, I really like Diablo 3 a lot. And maybe you hate it, whatever, that doesn't matter. Path of Exile is terrible. Don't play that. That's for Nick. But I really like Diablo 3 a lot. It inspires me. As I play it, it's a little bit mindless, but as I play it, it gets me thinking about 3D dungeon generation and stuff. And if you've played Diablo 3, they have procedurally generated dungeons, but they're concerned with the structure of the dungeon. What I mean by that is, where are the doors, where are the pathways, and how do you get to the exit point, right? You have an entrance point and an exit point, and how do you get there? But the actual rooms themselves don't really matter in the game at all. There are things to break, that's fine. It has barrels and stuff that are placed, and you can break them, tables, you can break whatever. They have handcrafted rooms. They like make their rooms, and I'm sure there's some even procedural generation within those rooms, a little bit for decoration, like I said, of these barrels and stuff. But in general, they like design this thing, and then they put it together procedurally, okay? So that is actually the exact opposite of what it is that I'm trying to do. I don't actually care about the structure of my dungeons. I don't care that rooms are lining up and where 2 walls touch one another, there should be a door there. I don't actually care about that. I'll explain why I don't. So I'm actually trying to achieve something very different from what the field has been spending a lot of energy on. And so what does that look like? Here's just another example. In these kind of action RPGs, they care about geography and not so much decoration. Like Diablo 3 plays so fast, Path of Exile as well, or whatever, pick a mobile game. They play so fast, the individual geography doesn't matter. You just like flow on through and you're fighting the monsters and you're getting the loot, and that's what's really important. It turns out 23 years ago, there was a game called Daggerfall that was released. And that was a really awesome game, especially at the time. All my friends were playing it, we loved it. And the thing about it is the dungeons were really samey. That's not a technical term, I just created it. So the dungeons are very samey, and it really left a bad taste in my mouth. Basically to the point where if anybody talks about procedural dungeon generation, I think back to Daggerfall. And the reason that I can say it feels kind of samey is like this, like they create these chunks, and then they just kind of stick them together, right? Like those green lines are like points where 2 chunks can meet, and then you just kind of go from there. And so when I was playing Daggerfall, it was very obvious. I'm like, oh, here's this room again, right? And then I go on to the next one. Here's this room again. And so that just really kind of poisoned the well for me as far as making chunks or making pieces, like large pieces, rooms, and sticking them together. So don't reinvent the wheel. So here is a car, and the car has wheels. But do invent an airplane. So they also has wheels. We don't think about that much, but airplanes also have wheels, and then it goes in a whole different direction. And so that's what I'm talking about, is like I looked at everything that exists for procedural, well, obviously I didn't see everything, but I looked at, you know, a vast amount of stuff that's been written on this dungeon procedural generation, and then I went off and started making an entirely new thing like an airplane. So let's start with the what, and then we get into the how. So, in a recent talk on the CGDC Facebook group, G pointed out that hours of design saves you days of work. And so that's why it's really important to nail the what. So Alice is in Wonderland and she's talking to the cat there and she says, which way should I go? Well, that depends where you are going. I don't know. Then it doesn't really matter which way you go. And that is very true in game design. And so you really have to nail what is it that I'm actually trying to achieve. Begin with the end in mind is something that you will hear me say very often. So if you don't know where you're going, then you can't tell how close you are to getting there, right? And so this talk started with what is important for me to communicate to you about procedural dungeon design. And then I work backwards from that, from what those points were, to try to support them and show you hopefully what that is. That's the same thing I do with the design of my dungeons. So where do I get that what? So the first thing is, if you've heard me talk about my game at all, it is inspired by tabletop role-playing. I am trying to bring the tabletop role-playing experience to the computer. And you might think, well, wasn't that already done? And I would say, no, not really. We have some things that are sort of have the combat mechanics of role-playing games, but they don't have a lot of the things that makes role-playing at the table so interesting. So this is an example in a role-playing book of what a dungeon crawl looks like. And so you look at that map, yeah, it's got like a grid and a bunch of stuff on there. And then they have usually numbers or letters or something. And then they'll have like some paragraphs of text saying like what's actually in there, what the encounter is within there. Now, if you aren't familiar with D&D or games like that, generally speaking, you would not have a map on the table that you're actually moving miniatures on, like square by square by square. That's very board gamey. You would do that with a game like Descent, but you would not usually do that with D&D. So what usually happens is the players make some decision about like, hey, I want to open that door that's on the east. And then the GM will tell them what happens when they open the door to that room on the east. And if there is combat or something, maybe they whip out the miniatures in a grid or something like that. But that's when that occurs. Just another quick example of that is this procedural generation website called Donjon, and they will create dungeons for you. And so you can see the dungeons over there on the left. Wow, look at that, it's cool. And then on the right, then you have a list of, hey, when it says, you know, one or A or four or whatever, you look at it over on the right and it tells you like what's there. Oh, this is what I find. This is what's interesting about this room. So each room has maybe some talking point that provides lore, flavor, maybe in a combat encounter, maybe not, a trap or something like that. And generally you want these things to be like that. Another form of inspiration is from this super old game that you're probably going to laugh at the graphics. I think they're great. Dungeons of Daggeroth. And I really loved this game as a kid. So this for me, again, because of the time frame, like I was 8 years old or something, and I was playing this game, and I was like, man, this dungeon crawl is incredible. And when I see that guy at the front that's kind of leaning over with his axe, in the graphics doesn't even look like an axe, looks like a club, but whatever. That reminds me of being really scared. And part of that was really the sound experience. The sound you could hear when an enemy was 3 steps away, and then you would make a move, and you could hear he's 2 steps away, and then you make a move, and you're like, oh no, this is coming at me. And so that was just a scared, kind of terrified feeling when I was playing this game as a kid. So it really stuck with me. Another game that really stuck with me is Eye of the Beholder. This is one of the first role-playing games that had a 3D dungeon that you could walk around in with kind of nice graphics. They had real-time combat, and it wasn't the first one. Dungeon Master was the first one, but this was a very strong, good one in the early years. And I remember wandering around in these dungeons and stuff, and they would just do simple things about just changing the textures on the walls, and then, ooh, I felt like I was on a new level. Just basic things, but they work. They still work. And so there was also a level of interaction with these things. Like if I want to go through that gate, I have to pull the lever on the wall, and then that gate opens, and then I have, you know, X amount of time that I need to get through that in order to go through. And so they're not really complicated, but it was good enough at that time. And so this inspires my design. And the final one is Ultima Underworld. And this one was the first one that had a true 3D view into a dungeon. When I say true 3D, like you could look up, you could look down, you could look at anywhere. You weren't walking in steps anymore. You were moving smoothly through it. Basically like the Quake engine. Like there was this, and then many years later was the Quake engine. There was a system governing the, I got an error pop up here. Oops. There we go. So there's a system that was governing the monsters and how they interacted with you and stuff. And so it was interesting to see this dungeon that wasn't procedurally generated, but had systems that were making the dungeon feel a lot different based on your gameplay choices. And this game went on to influence Bethesda. So if you've played Skyrim, it comes back to this. Valve, Deus Ex, Bioshock, all these things come back to this game. So, what is the feeling that I am trying to get out of this initiative? The first thing is being there. I really want to have a feeling of being there. And secondly, I want a feeling of danger. So, being there and danger, those are the feelings that I'm going for. So now it matters which direction I take at Alice's, you know, path, because I'm trying to achieve that. So, there's two ways that you can design your level or your game experience, and I call them traversal and narrative. Okay, so traversal, you've all played. It is in WoW, it's in Skyrim, it's in Dragon Age, it doesn't matter, it's in Baldur's Gate. It's where you have some dude on a map and you walk around. Maybe you're walking around in first person, maybe you're walking around in third person or isometric or whatever, but you are walking around and exploring some space. If you need to get from one combat encounter to another combat encounter, you have to walk every single map tile to that, or you have to cross some geography or whatever in order to get to that. And then you have that next experience, okay? The other is the what I call narrative approach, and that is really just nodes. You are just moving from scene to scene like a movie would, and that doesn't require any traversal. You just experience, and you're given a choices one thing at a time. So that thing on the right is an example of somebody's D&D campaign and just what the various nodes are. So I find that much, much closer to tabletop, and that's what I'm going for in my game. I don't want all that traversal stuff. I want that experience-to-experience narrative node approach. One of my fans suggested this book. It's AD&D Dungeoneer's Survival Guide, and it was a really interesting read. It's so early in the D&D history that they didn't even know what they were doing, and they were just making up random rules and providing history and geology and like all kinds of interesting stuff in the book. And it got me really inspired and thinking about like, why do these caves exist? Why do these dungeons exist? And it really got me thinking, they actually pointed out, it's like, you need to know why your dungeon exists. It exists because some people need to live somewhere. It exists because they're trying to hide something. It exists because there's some evil thing that needs to be kept here and nobody else should be able to touch it. And that's gonna really change the kinds of rooms, therefore the kinds of experiences that you have within your dungeon. Every room needs to have a purpose within your dungeon. So, what are my system goals for this project? I want variety. I don't want it to be samey, right? Like Daggerfall. I want distinctive experiences. I want you to remember that time in the game, in the story, when this happened. And it looks and feels different than that other time. I want it to be narrative driven. As I just explained with those nodes, I want interactivity within the dungeon. I want the player to do things in the dungeon, not just like walk around and look for things to bash over the head. Okay, so that, I don't really mean it in the sense of puzzle solving because I'm not a huge fan of puzzles, but that example of, hey, there's a lever two rooms over, you pull it, then you go to the other room, hey, look, it opened the thing, like that's like very small level of puzzling. That kind of interactivity is interesting and to me anyway, and that's what I'm trying to do. Environmental storytelling is very important. So this is something that really kind of got big and popular when the first BioShock came out, was like you can just walk into a room and kind of know what's going on. You don't have to listen to the audiobook. You know what's going on there. And so I want to achieve this with my procedural dungeons. Okay, very, very different from what Diablo or Skyrim are trying to do. I need lighting for mood. I didn't realize when I started this how important lighting is to setting mood. I mean, any artist will tell you that, but I'm not an artist, so I didn't know. So anyways, they told me, hey, this is super important. And so I was like, okay, I need to address that. I need to have something for that. And verisimilitude, that's it. Verisimilitude is, does it feel true? Does it ring true? Does it feel real in some sense? That is what I want to achieve with my dungeon. And finally, I want to meet player expectations. Players show up to a role-playing game with certain expectations. And so I need to meet some of those expectations. I want to meet all their expectations. I don't know if that's possible, but I at least can meet some of them. Okay, so how do I do that? The how. I came across this board game called Dungeon Quest because I was searching for dungeon and quest in an image search, and this thing came up. I'm like, that sounds really good. I should see what it is they're doing. I am very inspired by the mechanics of board games. The reason I'm inspired by the mechanics of board games is because the mechanics of board games are obvious. They are there in the rules and on the cards. They can tell you what is actually going on. A video game, it's a little harder. It's more subtle. There's more going on behind the scenes than meets the eye and stuff, and so it's very difficult. So if I'm trying to build a game as an indie, small team, and if I can look at board game mechanics, chances are pretty good that I can translate those mechanics into my indie game, as opposed to looking at Skyrim and going, okay, how do I copy what 70 people did to my game, right? So in Dungeon Quest, they have this board, it doesn't matter what the board looks like, and then you go down these stairs into a catacomb. Where's the catacomb? There isn't one. It just has this deck of cards, and you just flip them over, and it's like, okay, you are at a place that has a secret door. Okay, flip over the next one. You are at a place that has a hidden trap. You are at a place that now has the exit, and you can get out of the catacombs. And I was like, that's great. That's brilliant. That reaches exactly what tabletop is like, where I simply tell you, okay, this is what happens. Make your choice. This is what happens. Make your choice. This is what happens. So this idea of having a deck that represents the dungeon that has been put in with X number of cards. It could be like 50 cards, but it creates a deck of maybe 10 or 12 experiences that you will hear me talk about very often. So you need to know that there's this card deck thing going on. So the next thing I did was, is this actually a good idea? Who knows? I think it's a good idea, but you know, I'm going to start building something, and if I'm going to dedicate now like years of my life to this thing, I want to know if it's actually any good. So this whole idea of, like, can you do a dungeon crawl without the traversal, with just the narrative approach, I wanted to test that. And fortunately, I had a group of fans that were willing to test things that I throw at them. Those are the best kind of fans. And so I created this crappy little prototype and threw my concept into that. So this is how the prototype starts up. Hey, you're in the town, then you pick a dungeon, you click it, and then it goes and it creates a deck of dungeon rooms, basically. And so this would be the first one. You start at the entrance, it gives you some choices, and then you say, okay, I'm gonna move. And then you go to the next thing. Okay, now we're in a place that's flooded. Do you wanna proceed forward in this room? Yes, I do. And then there's some die checks and some skill checks and stuff that happen, and you're like, okay, I achieved that. Oh, I go into the next room, and there's some monsters that jump out. Now that's gonna bring me a combat encounter. This is exactly what tabletop is like, if you've had a chance to play it. And so I tested this on the players, on the fans, and they said, yeah, actually, I like this. And maybe not all players like that. If you're very used to console RPG gaming, you're like, what is this junk? But that's okay, because you're not my core fan. My core fan thought this was pretty good. So here's just an example of a room. And this is supposed to be a room where you can search and maybe find some treasure and stuff. And so yeah, so that's what that room looks like. So then I was like, okay, I don't want these rooms to be, of course, samey, right? So what can I do in order to make these rooms look different? So I started doing procedural generation and putting things on the wall and the floor and putting tables in and having furniture and all this stuff. And I was like, you know, I have no idea what that looks like. So I spent a day, basically a day of my time, half a day of the artist's time, just putting together some stuff and just like whipping up some stuff and seeing like what can I achieve? And what I was able to achieve, actually, I was pretty happy with. So this is a different room, right, from this one. And based on the assets, I don't have a lot of assets, but I was looking at it, I'm like, actually, I kind of like this. And each one of those things you can click, and maybe it's trapped, and maybe it has gold inside or something. And it started getting pretty interesting. But if you look really closely at it, you start to see some of the problems. You know, going back to Jeff's thing of like the how may we, I identified like, you know, okay, you know what, there's gonna be problems with this, especially with perspective and the sizing of things. So zooming that up, look, that looks terrible. Right? So how do you address that? Well, you can have rules about how closely that thing can be placed to that ceiling crossover point of the wall and the ceiling. That starts to get really specific, right? So how many of those rules are you going to put in? You know, so probably you would just kind of cap it at a certain height so that would like never occur. So I was like, okay, so then I went and built 2D dungeons using basically what you just saw in that prototype. And I started building 2D dungeons, and this is what I put out as part of the pre-release that fans have played. And so this is just an example of some random room with a bunch of stuff that's been generated in it. And so this is one room, and then when I go to the next room, this is a different room. Do you feel like it's a different room? No, not really, okay? Nobody screamed out yes. So no, not really. Like it's sort of different and stuff, and I guess that's okay. Look, here's another one. Look at how different that room is. Come on. This one had a carpet, and this one doesn't have a carpet. You're clearly in an entirely new room, and this is a very exciting role-playing game. This dungeon crawl's awesome. Okay, so then if we went into this room, it's really different because you have so many more things that you can search and stuff. And so this is starting to show really some of the limitations of this. And I'm like, okay. Now, I've not actually built a 3D game before. I've only done 2D stuff. And so I was trying to stick within my, you know, comfort zone or things that I know and stuff. And I know 3D is expensive and you can get lost in all these rabbit holes and stuff. And so I was pushing pretty hard to like, how can I do this in 2D? So fine. So I was like, you know what? What we need is a different perspective for certain kinds of rooms. So I created this perspective, which is an east-west room. This is a corridor that's east-west. It has a whole bunch of stuff in it. And I was like, hey, if we had like different ways of putting columns or braces along the thing, if we had, you know, chains or no chains or different kinds of things, the torches change, you know, we could get like a different kind of feel to this room. And I was like, well, that's okay, maybe for east or west, so what about north or south? So we're like, okay, so here's a north or south. And so now that we have a north and south, I can again do the same kind of tricks. We're talking a lot of art assets at this point. So not only does there need to be a lot of different kinds of columns and you know, pikes that are on the ground and bones that are on the ground, and I can do scaling and stuff and as to where these things are they far into the distance, or are they up close to the camera? I could do those kinds of tricks, but some of the things I can't do tricks on, I actually need something different because of the lines of perspective. So going back to this room, I can't use the paintings on those walls on this room. So now I've doubled my asset load for my artist, and then if I went back to that first room, that's even different set of assets. So now I have three times the assets, and then I'm like, wow, this is actually getting quite expensive staying within this 2D space. So what were the issues? Obviously I talked about that. So it's samey. I still have not escaped being samey. So the room sizes don't really vary, and that's a huge problem. I want the feeling of you are exploring like a prison cell, and you are exploring like a cathedral room, or you're familiar with Lord of the Rings, Mines of Moria, like it's so cavernous, right? Like, and I want that kind of feeling. So I'm not getting there. And I spent a number of days trying to figure out how I can get a big room feel in this 2D space. And honestly, I couldn't do it. As I already said, three times the art assets. The lighting is actually very difficult to fake. So going back to that feeling of danger and mood, there are some things that you can do in 2D, but they're very limited. And so it was really difficult on the lighting front. The camera is always the same. As soon as I move that camera left or right, as soon as I pan it, all the assets blow up and they're like no good anymore. So that's a huge problem. Screen resolution issues. So when I played this thing on a Mac, which is 16 by 10, some of the doors were not appearing correctly as to where they are. If you're playing 16 by 9 on a PC, then they were. And so it was like, this is, you know, I got to solve these problems. As I said, doors. And the south door is a huge issue. How do you show that there's a door to the south? I tried a lot of things and did not find a solution to that. So basically you'll see later, I just threw an arrow in. So as we were going through all this and analyzing these issues and saying we have this target and we're really not getting close to that despite a bunch of different attempts. Roger, my artist, said, why don't we try 3D? And I was like, boo, hiss, let's not do that. So, okay, fine. Let's take a week and explore what 3D dungeons might actually look like, okay? So the first question is, how do you generate that room? Well, there's a couple of different ways. The chunk approach. So the chunk approach can have big chunks, little chunks, but at the end of the day, they're chunks. So using the Daggerfall example where whole rooms are a chunk, this is something for role-playing called Dwarven Forge. So these are like resin pieces that are painted, and then you just like stick them together, and then that's however big your room needs to be. And so I was like, okay, that's kind of interesting. Maybe I could explore that. This is the approach that Nick suggested. You can go further to what I would call piece. So piece, this is a different thing for role playing, and this is where you use plaster and you put it into molds, which you can see over on the side, and it spits out these little tiny pieces, and those little tiny pieces can be assembled in order to create larger, more complex pieces. So if you want floors, you just throw in a bunch of floor, small floor pieces. If you want walls, there's a bunch of pieces that add up to becoming a wall. I looked into this and I was like, yeesh, that's like a lot of work. And so that website I referenced earlier was a guy playing around with this piece approach. And so here he was talking about, okay, I got these pieces, or I got some items he bought in the asset store that he could start piecing together procedurally. He started running into problems with floor space and figuring out exactly where the floors are, and is this a corner, is it not a corner? How do you handle the corners correctly? Where do you put the doors in and stuff? So I was reading that and I was like, wow, that really sounds like pretty complicated. I don't really want to do that. So I had a bit of an aha moment, and it's not totally aha, but it's a bit of an aha. And what I realized is a dungeon is just a big fat square. And no matter like how big the room is, it's essentially a square. So if I could then make geometry that could make that square, then I don't have to worry about all that floor spacey stuff that that guy was dealing with the pieces and trying to build up a wall vertically through small pieces and building it up. And so I looked at some assets that are basically in a giant square room, and you throw a bunch of assets in there and stuff, and actually it looks pretty cool. Why does it look pretty cool when it is actually a big square room? Well, because of the way they decorated it with these little assets. So these assets are available on the Unity store, and they're called Multi-Story Dungeon, and they give you all the assets with the textures and everything and stuff, and they're really great. So here's like a whole bunch of stuff that you get as part of that asset, and I started playing around with that. So I'm always thinking about how can I sharpen my axe? And there's this great line in Ecclesiastes, if the iron is blunt and one does not sharpen the edge, he must use more strength. But wisdom helps one to succeed. So I'm always thinking as I'm working, like how can I work better? How can I work faster? What is a better approach than what I'm currently doing? Here's a quote from the book Blood, Sweat, and Pixels, which is part of the Small Group 201 curriculum. And here, this is a developer on Destiny. He doesn't give his name, but that's okay. So the biggest differentiator between a studio that creates a really high quality game and a studio that doesn't isn't the quality of the team, it's their dev tools. If you can take 50 shots on goal and you are a pretty sucky hockey player, and I can only take 3 shots and I'm Wayne Gretzky, you're probably gonna do better. That's what tools are, how fast you can iterate. It's the least sexy part of development, yet it's the single most important factor there ever is. Good tools equals better game, always. Now, maybe you don't think Destiny's all that great of a game, but that doesn't matter. I still think this guy's right. So, starting with this, like, how am I gonna do 3D dungeons? I started with my game as it was, and when I start my game, I have to generate a procedural world. Before you can do anything, there has to be a world. So when I go and I start up my game and I start generating a world, it does that in 20 seconds, and then you start off in a town. And when you're in the town, then you have to leave the town. So you leave the town, then you go and you start walking along a map, and you have to find where the dungeon actually is. So then you go and you look, okay, I explored the whole map, and then, hey, those green things, those are dungeons, because I have dev tools that show me where the dungeons are, so I can go and I can walk there. And then when you walk there, then you have to search the tracks and see what creatures are actually living here and where is their home. And so you search that and you get a success on that. And now you can actually go inside and now you see your 2D dungeon. So that's kind of a bit of a process in order to do that, right? So then I started thinking, okay, well, if the key to quality is iteration, it takes me 90 seconds from when I hit play to actually getting to my dungeon and being able to try something out. So that's about 40 iterations an hour. if I want to test things, make a small change and then retest. So then we had this thing we call the D key. So you still have to start the game, still takes 20 seconds in order to generate the world, but I hit the D button and bam, I'm right in a dungeon. So now I'm at 200 an hour that I can test. I then created a separate project that didn't require the generation of the world, and now from when I hit the Unity Play button, I go in, now it's 10 seconds. And so now I'm at 375 an hour. And then I decided I'm gonna make a Unity Editor add-in that uses a Unity window, and I got it down to 0.3 seconds, and that allows me to do 12,000 tests an hour. And now I can really iterate and make my algorithms better. So you need to get to this point. If you're doing any procedural work, you need to get to this like 12,000, 5,000, 4,000 per hour in order to be able to test your algorithms, because you get to see like all the outliers and everything for it. The second thing is my artist, Roger, I asked him to make up a sample, like where are we going with this? What am I trying to achieve? And so this he made up in Unity, and then he cheated a little bit with Photoshop, I found out later. But anyways, generally he made this in Unity and said, okay, great, this is what I'm gonna try and go for. Can I achieve this? And that's what I started working on. And now we get crunchy. Everybody ready? Buckled in? Okay. So I have a deck and I have cards. And the cards tell me that's this kind of a room. Cards tell me that this is where monsters are. Cards tell me there's traps. Cards tell me that there is something to find here. There's a quest item, there's a boss, or that kind of thing. So I have my deck of cards that are making up my dungeon. I take that deck of cards and I pass it into an algorithm that gives me room structure. So that generates the structure of my room, which goes into the data model. I also pass that into the objects, and that determines what kind of objects. Well, what kind of objects is that? Well, if I'm in a study, then a study is probably gonna have a table and a chair and a bookcase and papers, okay? But if I'm in a barracks or a dining hall, they probably don't have papers. They have tables, they have chairs, but they probably have multiple chairs, not just one chair. So like these are the kind of things that are going into the object algorithm. I then have a creator, which is a race, so I have dungeon races, and there's creators, and the creator determines that kind of room structure, meaning what materials did they use? And this allows me to tie into the lore of my world, and I have different ages to it. So let's say in the earliest age, they used like marble and gold and those kinds of things that are really expensive and valuable. So they would create that thing. So when the player walks in, this is a bit of the environmental storytelling, they can immediately tell, oh, this place is old. Right? And that should maybe get you excited about the kind of treasure and stuff there, maybe gives you an indication of the kind of monster stuff that are there. The second thing is, what kind of objects would that race have? So if they're humans, maybe they have banners hanging on the wall, okay? So that would be a kind of object that's there. And then the second part is, who currently occupies it? Because my world is procedurally generated, then it has a procedural history of everything that happened, very Dwarf Fortress-y. The people that made the dungeon are not necessarily the things that are living in the dungeon. So humans made this dungeon and abandoned it due to the plague, and then you have wolves that moved in there and just use it as a den. So how are they gonna change the way that this dungeon looks? They are gonna change it. Structure is still the same, but maybe the tables are broken now or something like that. There's different things that are race related to that. And so that extra level of decoration is a different algorithm that goes through in a different pass, putting those things in. So all that stuff, all that thinking and rules and everything goes down into the room data model. The room data model is totally separate from actually seeing the room, and there's two reasons for that. One is because that's the proper way to do software and you should always do it that way, okay? Can I get an amen? There we go. Okay, second reason is that I need to save the dungeons, and I need to save them before you've even seen them. So if I generate that data model ahead of time, I can save it. So when you go into a room that you've never seen before, it displays it in a certain way, and then when you go back to that room, I'm not generating it, I'm just loading it, okay? So that allows it to look exactly the same as it did last time. That room data model is passed into the room drawer, because that's what I named it. It's draw room, so it's a room drawer. And that is what actually generates it onto the screen. So data model goes through room drawer, and that's what you see on the screen. So what does my data model look like? Well, it's really basic. I figured out a 3D dungeon is really just a 2D dungeon with some verticality in it, and there's a few things that I've done for the vertical space. But in general, you're looking at a top-down view of a dungeon and what stuff is there. So if I've already placed a cabinet somewhere, that's what the C's are, well, I can't put something else there. The cabinet's like taking up the space. And I found out that you can't put a cabinet and then a table right next to the cabinet, because nobody would ever do that. So then I had to put in rules of like reserving space around doors, reserving space around tables, so you can actually get to and from the table and that kind of stuff. And so that's my data model, and it allows me to debug this thing. And that's the most important thing when you're doing procedural, is you have to see what decisions are being made by the algorithms, what are they outputting? Because the drawer might be wrong in where it's putting something. So I have to look at a data model and see, where is it supposed to be? Oh, it's supposed to be at X3, and then I look on the screen, it's not actually at X3, so there's something wrong with the drawer. Or if it, you know, if the drawer is doing it correctly, then there's something wrong with the algorithm. So it's very important to be able to see that. And so that's why I have that. Now, conceptually, this is how a room is made up. Rooms are full of room features. And so you have this big kind of empty canvas, and there's just a bunch of features. Room features are then split into floor objects or wall objects. Wall objects stick on walls, floor objects stick on floors. Floor objects are things like columns, beds, cupboards, tables, bones, or decals. Wall objects are doors, paintings, banners, decals, like whatever else that would go on a wall. Okay, so I put some color coding to this just to kind of give you a quick idea. I can have objects in my room, so that's like the blue, just it's an object, something you can see, but only two of them are actually searchable. That's a choice that I made in my game. You can't just search everything in a room. You can only search things that actually have something you can find. That's a design choice, plays fast, I like it. Okay, so that's a room. So then I started generating that, and I found out, you know what, when you randomly place stuff, it looks really terrible. So there you go, it looks terrible. And maybe you already knew that, but apparently I had to do it and prove it to myself. If you apply a few rules to it, like, hey, cupboards can only go against walls, it actually got a whole lot better. Like, it wasn't much of a change in order to add those rules to cupboards only, and get them say, hey, I'm going to place myself in a proper orientation. So this room looks better. There is logic and stuff that goes into these placement rules, and basically I'm starting to build an expert system. How would I design it myself, or how would a level designer design this? Okay, let's take those fundamentals and put them into the algorithm, and then we can start to get things look kind of realistic. Now, so one thing you take away from this, it's all about the fudge. Okay, fudge is everything, especially in this procedural generation. So, if it's all about the fudge, here is no fudge. Okay, I put barrels in a room, and it looks exactly like an algorithm put barrels in a room, right? It's terrible. I made one change. I add the fudge algorithm, and now it kind of looks like somebody made that, okay? I mean, your mileage may vary on what you think of that, but totally an algorithm. And, interesting, okay? It's imperfections that bring out the humanity of the placement or the creation, okay? Let's take a little example here. Let's say we hired Steve Gaynor from Fulbright, and he's a level designer, and he's worked on things like BioShock and his own game of Gone Home. And let's see what it takes to get him to do our levels. So there's initial investment of calling up Steve, say, hey, Steve, I got this awesome game, you should work on it. He says, great, I'll do it. Let's say that's 2 hours. Okay, let's say that Steve, he's a really good level designer. 50% of the things he puts down stay there because it's awesome. Okay, so Steve's a good level designer. Now, let's say when it comes to training Steve, he's already pretty darn good, but you know, he could always get better. So if we spend time training Steve, let's say he gets 1% better per hour. So you have to put 20 hours in, now he's 70% good at putting things down in the room. And let's say that Steve, he's a real go-getter. He likes to work hard, and he puts down things at 1 per minute, okay? So Steve can generate good 30 object rooms per hour. One. He could generate one per hour, okay? Because that 50%, how many per minute and stuff, okay? So we get one room per hour. That's pretty darn good for a level designer. We have a level designer here. Can you make one kind of level area in 1 hour? Yeah.
Sure.
Sure. I think it takes a lot longer than that. Okay, so let's put Steve against the algorithm. So you have an initial investment, added up my work logs, 212 hours so far on these algorithms. My quality per placement, let's say it's 1%. The training efficiency. So for every hour that I put into improving the algorithm, like the cupboards and putting a little rule in, say, you know what, you can only be against a wall. It goes up by, let's say, 5%. I mean, it's very subjective numbers, but anyways, that's my feeling having worked on it, is like, wow, for every hour I spend on the placement of a table, it actually gets a lot better where the placement of the table is. My placements per minute are 36,000. So good 30 object rooms per hour, I can generate 72,000 pretty good rooms per hour. I was working on more and more sophisticated placement algorithms, but what I sort of clued into was actually, the computer's really fast, and so I don't actually need a good algorithm, I just need to place things down fast and check to see, is this a good spot? No. Is this a good spot? No. And so I actually saved myself tens of hours, dozens of hours of work by just having it try lots. And so it just tries lots, and I was pretty happy with the results. So here is a room. And then I was like, okay, well, I need to put objects on top of objects. Well, that's really simple. I was able to think about, like, how would you get things on top of a table or a barrel or on shelves and stuff. And so I play a lot of The Sims. I like The Sims, think it's pretty cool. And if you ever play The Sims, when you go to like put something like a TV down or you know, chairs at a table or something like that, they have these kind of defined points where you can do that. And so I call those anchor points. And I was like, hey, that's a pretty good idea. What if I just created anchor points? And then I know where I can place things. So I did that. I went in and I just figured out, what are the anchor points for this particular thing? Here's the anchor points. And so now I'm able to use the anchor points, and the objects are able to fill themselves. I don't have to place the things on there. And I have all kinds of little tiny objects that I could put on there, and I can fudge them, and they don't have to fill all of them. Right now it's set to 100% fill rate, so I could see that it's filling correctly. But if you look at like the chairs, for instance, on that table in the foreground, not all the chairs are there. There's six possible chair placements. It only has two. It makes it kind of interesting, makes it kind of different, right? And maybe the person's playing, why is there only two chairs? Why are they on that side? Where do the other chairs go and stuff? This is part of the imagination part of the game for the player. Now, camera placement. These are essentially the same room, but the camera's just different. And when you move the camera, it actually gives you, obviously, a different perspective to the room, and it actually makes the room kind of feel, you know, different. And so that's a huge advantage in 3D. The next one is with the lighting. So here in this room, I have no lighting turned on, just the stuff is placed on there, and there it is. So that's actually the closest I could get to kind of my 2D rendering, following the rules. Here it is with lighting. It makes a huge difference to the mood. Like, it's starting to feel a lot more like I am there. And then you can put on post-processing effects, and then you start to get a lot closer to, like, I'm there, especially start throwing in some particle effects and stuff. Those particle effects, they can be driven by the race, right? So if the undead are there, we have different particle effects if the undead are living there than if it's, say, wolves or something. So then I was like, okay, now how do I make these rooms, like, this is a generic-looking room, how do I make this room feel more goblin-y or feel more wolfy? And so I had this idea of, like, hey, I can make these kind of cards that define what the hallway would look like. And I started going down this path of making like a goblin hallway and making a spider hallway. And I was like, this is getting kind of stupid. I need to do a better solution than this. And so I realized that actually all hallways have the same general parameters to them. Again, it's this level of decoration that you do on top. And so I started adding that level of decoration. And so this is, again, I'm not finished. It's not the most impressive thing, but this is what a human one looks like. Okay, it's got some banners on the wall. I don't have a lot of assets yet, but it's got some banners on the wall. And then if I switch in my dropdown from humans to goblins, now I have goblin banners, and I got some blood splatters and stuff. Like, the place is starting to get kind of mucky and yucky. Okay, so hopefully you get the concept, even if you're not totally thrilled with exactly what the graphics here are. But that's the general idea, and that's where this thing is going. So now, how do we populate these dungeons? Okay, so in a role-playing game, you have things like treasures, items, secrets, and monsters. So treasure placement, I actually look at the whole deck of all of the possible rooms. I look at all of the rooms and the things that were generated inside of them, like cupboards and barrels and whatever, and I look at those, and these are simply objects that are flagged as searchable, like they're possible to be searched. Okay, like a blood splatter, that's not something you can search, but maybe a painting hanging on the wall, you can. So you have this list of searchables, and then I just go in and just start plunking down things in the searchable. So I don't, at this point, I don't even know what room they're in. I just, because I'm looking at all of the searchables for the entire dungeon. So I know that your quest object is in this dungeon. I don't know where it is. That to me is fun as a game designer, the one who made the game. I'm still exploring and looking for these things as well. So it makes it fun for me to test. And then of course you can't wiki, you know, in order to find out where do I find the, you know, the Holy Grail or something like that. So that's one of my goals that I'm trying to achieve. And so those purple ones that are searchable, they will actually show up when you mouse over them. That's how I know that it's highlightable. So monster placement gets more complicated, and I won't go into all the reasons why it's more complicated for my game than another game. But the general idea is that over the passage of time, layers grow more and more monsters. So they start off spawned with a few monsters, but over time they get more monsters. Those monsters are placed into patrols. You can see that there's like small patrols and large patrols. So like the boss would be on the top patrol with all those monsters. And then I have my levels. We just recently added multi-levels to the dungeons. So now I have multiple levels to my dungeons. So you would expect when you're doing the monsters, that they would have the easier monster patrols on the top level and the harder monster patrols. So this is how it goes through. It says, okay, I got these monster patrols, and they're made up already of certain combat groups, and it starts placing them into the rooms. And it doesn't even matter to me how the rooms are connected. So you might get three combats in a row, you might get no combats for three in a row. And then it starts going to the harder ones and putting the harder ones in the lower thing. So if the player was to abandon after kind of doing level one doesn't repopulate. And I think that meets player expectation because I could make the algorithms repopulate and redistribute the population and stuff, but I don't actually want to do that. So yeah, the harder ones go in there until you finally place the boss. And now the final thing in this placement is things like key placement. Whatever the gate happens to be, you need a gem, you stick it in an idol, you have a key, it opens a door, whatever it happens to be in order for the person to progress. So since I don't care about the geography of my dungeons, I don't care that one dungeon room is very long and it has a door going east, and that goes into a room that's very short that has a door going south, and then that room is very long and has a door going to the east, then I don't care that those things don't really line up because of the narrative-driven approach. But in the case of key placement, if you look at where you're coming in on this dungeon and you start going through, you hit the locked room before you can even get to the key. And so when it comes to procedural, you have to provide the players with lots of options. You can't just have one way. Otherwise, it starts to get really hard and really crazy for the algorithms. So because I have multiple ways of getting through a door, you bash it down, you burn it down, you can use a crowbar to pry it open, you can use a lockpick in order to go in. There's like a bunch of ways you can get through a door. Now it doesn't matter. And so if you find a key and you're able to get through the door, then you feel great. And if you don't have the key, you're like, okay, bash my way in, and I still kind of feel great. So this is kind of where I'm at with my dungeons, and where am I going forward with this? Well, the next thing is to add in the audio experience. I unfortunately didn't get to that yet. But James is going to help me put in the audio experience, and this should really help. And so when I talk about putting in the audio experience, if you ever played Minecraft and you're getting close to like lava, you start to hear like a sound. That's the kind of idea, is like telling and hinting and foreshadowing like what's about to come, going back to Dungeons of Daggeroth. So that's the next thing. I can do that because I've procedurally generated all my rooms. I know where the monster patrols are. I know how far away you are from those monster patrols. I know what the monster patrols are made up of, and I can start to telegraph that kind of thing to the player. It's taken me 6 months to get the 3D engine behaving pretty much the same as the 2D engine did. And that's a whole lot of time, but I think the results are a whole lot better. And now as I start to add in the interactivity that I was gonna add in before with the 2D dungeons, I feel a lot better about it. The level of interaction that we're currently working on is having multiple levels of dungeon, water systems, so water that flows between rooms. You can use doors to open and close and move the water around. Different kinds of doors, like they're stuck, they're locked, they're whatever. Levers and switches, and keys and gating. But more importantly, I've built something for the future. This whole approach to building these rooms would work for a first-person shooter with modern stuff. Like, this is not tied just to doing 3D dungeons. The algorithms and the way that they decorate and they have like their races and stuff, that actually works for anything. That doesn't mean that I'm gonna start selling it, licensing it and stuff, but it just, I've created tech that is very valuable to me. that I can go forward with. And so I do intend to make Archmage Rises 2. I do intend for that to be 3D based. And so all this time and energy that I've put into this tech for Archmage Rises 1, I do expect to be able to pull into Archmage Rises 2. And of course I'm gonna change it and add to it for Archmage Rises 2, but it's something that has already kind of got me going into the future, and I like that. If I do this again, I wouldn't do it this way. And that's one of the values of coming to these talks and hearing, you know, what you did. I would actually go with the peace way. Even though there was like a lot of work that goes into figuring out those floor plans and corners and where the doors are and that kind of stuff, that's actually where I intend to go next. So a lot of what I've already built will help me with that. But if you were to start today, it might actually be worth it.